We're tilting against windmills in miniature golf, this time on Atari Archive. When discussing and playing Atari VCS games, a certain degree of abstraction is expected. Backgrounds are low resolution, and the missile and ball sprites are quite limited in appearance. As such, chunky sprites and blocks representing people, footballs, basketball hoops, cars, and so on are the norm. Even by these standards, miniature golf, also known as arcade golf, is an incredibly abstract take on golf's fast-paced, wacky cousin. Making a game out of this sport makes perfect sense in context. For the unfamiliar, mini-golf, or putt-putt golf in some parts of the world, puts players in small, specially designed courses where they have to putt a golf ball past obstacles, around tricky corners, up ramps, and into the cup. The game was in the midst of a boom period during the 1970s, and Atari was capitalizing. Miniature Golf was written by Tom Ruderdahl, and as the Sears name suggests, his VCS take on the sport is seemingly based off of an unreleased Atari arcade mini-golf game. Both games take an overhead approach to the courses, tasking players with knocking their ball through the course by indicating their angle of approach and power with a cursor. The course layouts were already rather generic on the arcade game, but are even more abstract on the VCS conversion. Using the background graphics, each course is essentially a puzzle of geometric shapes that the players must navigate their ball through. Much like the actual sport, each time you hit the ball, you score a point, with a goal of getting through the game with the fewest points possible. In true mini-golf fashion, miniature golf is really designed around tricky bank shots and good timing to avoid traps and obstacles in the 9 different courses you play through. This game was released in the period before Nintendo's golf really standardized the meter-based control scheme, but the idea of using a cursor to control power and angle is an interesting, if flawed, solution. The further away the cursor from the ball, the more power is behind the shot. The position of the cursor in relation to the ball controls the angle it is hit at. The difficulty switches adjust the friction for each player's ball. When flipped to A, the ball will zip along further than it normally does. This control scheme works to a point, but depending on the ball's position, it can hinder the game and make it needlessly annoying. Specifically, if the ball is up against the side of the screen, the player can only move the cursor a short distance out to the edge before they're stopped, in turn leaving them with an incredibly weak shot that won't go far. This can prove cumbersome when you otherwise have your angle set up and you just can't get the distance you need to make it work in one turn. This doesn't seem like it would be a huge deal at first, but it drags the game down and makes it that much harder to get a good score. It can also lead to your shots getting blocked on courses that have moving obstacles, as the lack of power knocks off the timing you hope for. You can try and adjust for it by moving to the other side and trying for a bank shot. This does work, but you do sacrifice some of your accuracy in not being able to line up your shots direct. Miniature Golf appears to have had a short shelf life on the VCS. Atari dropped it by the January 1981 CES show, and while this is purely supposition, the company publishing a straightforward golf game in 1980 may have had something to do with it. Atari Corporation brought back the game to sell a whopping 109 copies in 1987 and 88, and if you told me that was solely to get rid of old stock, I would believe it. Reviews from its heyday were also rather mixed, but generally fell on the side of it not having much to do with actual miniature golf. Xenia Gazette columnist Dick Cohen complained that it was difficult to get the ball around objects and into the cup. Arnie Katz, Bill Kunkel, and Joyce Worley wrote their thoughts about the game twice. The first time was in April 1980 video magazine column Arcade Alley, where they noted that while unrealistic and arcadey, it combined bumper cars, mini-golf, and billiards to create an intriguing game of obstacles for players to overcome. These sentiments were largely echoed in the July 1982 Electronic Games magazine write-up on sports video games, where miniature golf was mentioned as being withdrawn from the market and not terribly realistic, with a ball that bounced around like one from billiards. They did praise it for being challenging and having fast action, for which it certainly qualifies. And miniature golf as a video game concept seems to have been oddly overlooked for years. This may have had something to do with the relatively low resolutions and memory that early video game consoles had to work with, but it wasn't entirely a lost cause. Thanks to the unique indie development scene around the Bally Professional Arcade console, that created games using its robust basic programming carts and cassette tape interfaces, that specific console saw a few attempts at bringing the game home. Soterica published a mini-golf game for the Bally Professional Arcade in March 1981 that ran through the system's basic cart. This particular version has commonalities with Atari's in terms of control schemes, but features even more simplistic course designs, presumably due to the limited memory Bally Basic games had to work within. It also features an unfortunate glitch where the ball can get stuck inside the walls. Fortunately, after 6 putts, the game considers you to have hit the stroke limit and moves you along to the next one of 6 holes. Another Bally Basic author, Mike White, wrote his own take on putt-putt golf in December 1982 for the original Bally Basic cart. This was later converted to the later Astro Basic variant in March 1985. This was rewritten in 1993 by White to use the Blue Ram Basic third-party memory expansion, which added more color and speed, but was otherwise essentially the same game. White's game gets around the cursor issue by having you choose one of 8 directions to aim, and then lets you determine your force by twisting the controller's knob. The courses are a bit devious, with both static and moving barriers, water hazards, sand traps, and inexplicably landmines on the 18th hole. On the downside, being limited to 8 directions means that sometimes you end up wasting shots just to align the ball correctly. That said, this is probably the finest mini-golf game you're going to play on a game console from this era, with or without the RAM expansion. The concept cropped up a few times on home computers where memory and screen resolution were better suited to making the game work. A 9-hole miniature golf game for the TRS-80 and Atari's 8-bit computers was written and the basic code published in Softside magazine in 1981. This version seems to be somewhat similar to the VCS game. A decidedly more advanced Apple II mini golf game, which I haven't turned up a whole lot about, would also go on to be the basis for an unpublished Atari 5200 conversion. This game used the high-resolution modes on the 5200 and Apple II, with the 5200 version using the controller keypads to adjust angles and power. According to the website Atari Protos, this version of the game was shelved by Atari due to the funky colors the console's high-resolution graphic mode forced it into. But by all rights, any 5200 game that doesn't require players to work with the controller's non-centering analog stick can't be all that bad. The control scheme also avoids the problem seen in the earlier VCS game, and the higher resolution graphics allow for more elaborate and understandable, if still rather abstract, courses compared to its older counterpart. If this all sounds like I'm a bit down on miniature golf for the VCS, it's not because it's a bad game, it's actually an interesting one. Miniature golf is a game that really tries to do something unique and make a breezy, real-world pastime into a breezy video game experience. It doesn't quite succeed entirely due to its control issues, and the courses may be esoteric, but it is still an interesting diversion with another player. This is also, to my knowledge, Ruderdahl's sole software outing on the platform, and while he may not have developed an instant classic, his game is the exact level of quirky that defines 1970s VCS development. Next time, we wrap up Atari's spring releases with what is probably the least essential game the company ever sold on their own platform.